Hey, it's Chris Stuker for GeekNerdNet.com. I am at the 2023 Calgary Expo. I'm sitting with Arthur Adams. Hi.
Hi, how are you doing today?
I'm doing well, thanks. I think I just emphasized that enough for every fan that would probably sit beside you and talk to you at a convention. So, but seriously, though, I don't even know where to start, so we're going to start at the beginning. You've told this story a million times, I'm sure, but hey, why not tell it a bit again? Talk about your that creative spark, that moment that you're like, you know what, I'm going to do this for a living, or I'm just going to try it and see what happens.
All right. Well, gosh, thank you very much for speaking with me about this. So I started out, I was hoping I could be a paleontologist. And I found out that was a lot more work than I was actually willing to put in. But I loved dinosaurs, and through that I found I loved monsters. Through that I found Jack Kirby and Steve Ditko monster comics that were being reprinted around the time I was started getting comics, like in the late 60s, early 70s. And I was following those. I liked that. I liked the Fantastic Four because the Thing was there. I liked Hulk comics because he's a monster. And then somehow, just through following the comics I liked, I discovered Michael Golden's The Micronauts.
Nice.
And I think I was, I can't remember whether I was 15 or 16, something like that, when I saw that. And I was, that's when I thought to myself, this is what I would like to do for my career. Drawing comics looked like a lot of fun, and it was really interesting.
That's amazing. And, you know, you threw something out there that I was going to talk about, but I'm going to get to that later, about the dinosaurs, because that's cool fun. Who doesn't like dinosaurs? I love dinosaurs.
A surprising number of people. What's wrong with those people?
Right?
I don't understand.
Yeah,
them.
I don't either. It's ridiculous. you know, one of my favorite comics growing up through the 80s and 90s and is, you know, was Uncanny X-Men and X-Men, anything X-Men I could get my hands on, and Spider-Man too. But, you know, talk about your days. Like, your first series, it was Longshot that got you started in the business, correct?
Yes.
So talk a bit about something that turned out not to be a long shot. That was cheesy. But anyway, let's. I'll edit it out.
That's
maybe I won't.
Too late.
It's out there, right? I said it. I can't believe I threw a dad joke into this interview. I'm so sorry.
You know, it's all right. I am a dad, so dad jokes are part of the repertoire of almost every conversation. We're good.
Okay, so ignoring the stupid thing I just said, talk about Longshot, and then eventually you run into X-Men and all that amazing stuff.
Well, I had sent in my samples to Marvel Comics, and fortunately, people like Al Milgrom and Carl Potts saw my submissions and offered me a chance to do tryouts. I did those tryouts. I think it was about a half issue of a team book they were doing at the time. This was not to be published. This was just for their own, to see what I did. And they could help them point me in the right direction to do a better job, which they did, and I appreciated. But this was a superhero team book, and so there was a big fight scene, which I put a lot of work into. There was another scene that I put a lot of work into, which was some of the superheroes washing dishes after dinner, which Annie Nocenti saw and thought that was hilarious. So she thought maybe I would be good for this series that she'd been hoping to do called Longshot. Apparently she'd asked lots and lots of other artists to do it, and then none of them were terribly interested. I think mostly because it was a brand new character, and it was a superhero whose superpower was that he was lucky.
Yeah.
And certainly as I felt early on, I was like, I don't know how to draw someone being lucky. But I was 19 years old, and if they'd offered me Care Bears or G.I. Joe or the Transformers, I would have leapt at any of those.
Yeah.
So I was very happy to get offered a job.
Nice. And then you do that Longshot series, and then what was your next jump? Like, where did they put you after that?
So Louise Simonson had been the editor on Longshot, and during the course of my getting that done, she retired from being an editor to go be a full-time writer, which means the writer of Longshot, Annie Nocenti, became the editor of all the X-Men books, which meant that Chris Claremont was in her office all the time, and Chris had a reputation for poaching artists. Huh. Like, he'd see stuff on editors' tables and say, "I can that I'd like to work with that person. And fortunately, I'd run into Chris multiple times at comic book conventions, and I already got along well with him. So basically, Chris stole me from Annie. So otherwise, there might be more issues of Longshot. So it's if you wanted more issues of Longshot, it's Chris Claremont's fault that there aren't any more.
Nice. Well, the run aside is fantastic. In terms of, and please forgive me, now I'm blanking. Oh, my God. You had some creator-owned work in the...
Monkey Man.
Thank you. Oh, my God. How did I forget? I'm sorry, I forgot.
It's okay. I didn't do much of it. It's easy to forget.
Do you want to talk about it?
Sure, we can do that, yeah. So I'd been working for Marvel for a little while. I'd done a little bit of DC work. And one day I got a call from Eric Larson. And it was early days on Image there. And he invited me, not just me, but also Mike Mignola, to, if we were interested, trying our hands at doing creator-owned work. But at that time, I hadn't really thought about doing anything, making up stuff for myself, because I didn't really want to make up something. I mean, having just already done Longshot and all the characters that went with Longshot, wasn't really super eager to just give characters to either Marvel or DC Comics. Mm-hmm. But after Eric asked, I thought about it for a moment and thought about the things I loved when I was younger, like King Kong, and decided to try to come up with something featuring a oversized anthropoid and a pretty girl fighting monsters.
Nice. I love it.
Pretty basic.
Yeah. So, you know, you travel all over the world, conventions and all that good stuff, and I'm sure you've heard this a billion times. I'm going to throw it out there anyway because I want to. when you come to shows like this and you're in different countries and all that kind of stuff, that connective tissue of, you know, I'll just, like, geekdom, nerddom, I'm a nerd, whatever, I'm happy to be one, I love comics, you love comics. Does that almost kind of vibe, energy level, kind of keep you going, or is it more just, you're just happy to, you know, kind of shoot the shit and be here and show your work?
Well, I mean, there's that, of course, I'm happy to see people, and it's always nice to have people come by and say, you know, nice stuff, which almost always happens.
Yeah.
But also, it's a part of the modern comics industry. This is a part of our income now.
Yeah.
So it's a way to make some money and go new places. For instance, I'm here in Calgary, not too far from the Royal Tyrell Museum. Yeah. So I got to go visit that on this visit.
Yeah, please talk about that.
I had to go, I'll cover that maybe. I got to go see some amazing fossils, and fortunately the convention knows people who know people, so I got to have a backstage tour of the Royal Tyrell and got to see all kinds of really cool stuff and meet lots of people that were, you know, doing stuff I thought about doing when I was a little kid, right? And other times, my wife and I have been able to go to places like Singapore and have amazing food. We've been able to spend weeks at a time in Australia touring different parts of there and seeing amazing stuff in Australia, and, you know, getting to be able to travel to places like London and Paris, and soon we'll be going to a convention in Italy, in an area called Lake Como that's just beautiful. So yeah, it's amazing. We get started out sitting around drawing monsters, and next thing I know, people are excited about having us travel all over the world. So, you know, I'm super appreciative of that.
That's fantastic. Do you have a favorite world destination, basically everything you just mentioned, do you have a favorite world destination you like to go back to or want to go back to, or one you want to go to?
So, I mean, I'm sure there's some place I've never been to Japan. Mm-hmm. I'm a little worried about it because I like a lot of Japanese toys. And I'm a little worried that my wife will finally find a reason to leave me, because I'm a little worried I might go nuts there,
yeah.
Find some stuff that I really don't need but I really like.
Yeah.
And, you know, a lot of times when I'm traveling with my wife Joyce, we find places that, like, we could, you know, think about whether we could live there.
Yeah.
So, sure, when we were in Paris, we were like, oh, I could live in Paris. I could live in London. I could live in Sydney or Melbourne, Australia. So that's a super fun. Like,
Drumheller?
Well, maybe not Drumheller, but we've certainly considered Vancouver.
Yeah,
Vancouver's nice.
Yeah. I don't joke. Drumheller's very nice, and the dinosaurs are amazing.
Drumheller's amazing. Yeah. It's visually amazing. Yeah. I imagine when it's cold there, it's hella cold. And when it's hot
like
there,
here
it's hella
too,
hot.
Like in Calgary.
A bit. It's kind of out in the open plains, right?
Right? Yeah.
Yeah. So where I am in California, we're just outside of the Bay Area, so it's nice and moderate. It's a little bit like some parts of Italy or some parts of southern Spain. So that's like a little bit of southern France as well.
Yeah.
That's why it's the wine country out near where we are. So we keep finding places that might be interesting to live. We've not gotten around to doing that, but we've certainly considered it in the past.
Yeah. Now, you just mentioned you live just outside the Bay Area. Yeah. So Fan Expo San Francisco making its first official launch of their show in November last year.
Fantastic.
How was that?
It was their first show, and in the United States at that time, it's right around Thanksgiving. So a lot of people were surprised and a little confused by that, because a lot of people already have Thanksgiving plans. But, you know, I know Fan Expo is committed to making that a thing.
Yeah.
And I think eventually, if like they can hold out for a few years, it'll become like a destination, a Thanksgiving vacation destination. I certainly hope so, because I certainly like that it's there in the city. And makes it a little easier for us to travel, because our town, our home is just about 50 miles from there, so it's not too bad. Yeah.
Yeah. The thing I loved about the San Francisco show is one, when I landed, it was Thanksgiving on the Thursday, and so I had my second Thanksgiving, because Canadian Thanksgiving is in October. but so that was fun and great to hang out with friends and experience that. And but then to be at the show, I was super impressed. There seemed to be quite a few patrons there for a Thanksgiving weekend. That was, and a first show?
For a very first show. And I mean, there was people coming in from outside who didn't know it was there. And I know the very first night there was some concern amongst the retailers, but from when I was talking to people on Saturday, they seemed pretty happy.
Nice.
So I'm hoping it'll be a growing and successful adventure.
Fantastic. So before we go here, and I won't keep you too much longer, so I appreciate your time. Talk about the dinosaurs and talk about the Royal Tyrrell Museum and the behind the scenes tour and all that good stuff. Talk a bit about that.
Oh my goodness. Well, I got to hold a tyrannosaur arm bone. That was cool. And got to see all kinds of apparently the official gemstone of Alberta. It's ammonite, crystallized, some sort of special process that happens to some of them on the shell. So that was really cool. Got to see a bunch of those. Got to meet a bunch of the people who do the preparations. Got to see, wasn't allowed to take any pictures, but I saw them prepping a specimen that they're writing a brand new paper about that looks super exciting.
Oh, that's neat.
And got to see various of the specimens they've pulled from coal sands not too far from here, one of which was very amazing because it had apparently been packed up in its plaster jacket to be transported to the museum, and they cut into the jacket a couple of years ago and it started leaking oil, and apparently it's never stopped. It's just slowly dripping oil out of it, and they don't seem to really know exactly what to do about that, but they're also strangely fascinated.
That's amazing.
Gosh, and then what else?
You know, it's just venom, right?
Huh?
It's venom.
Yeah, I don't think that's it. Well, I mean, it might work the same. But then met a bunch of the artists who do work on the displays, and I was kind of jealous of them being able to do what they do. Certainly the kid in me would have been super, super jealous to see them be able to do that. So, yeah, it was a super fun visit. I was very grateful for the opportunity.
Nice. Well, listen, Arthur Adams, thank you so much for making time for me. And
thank you for visiting.
I can't wait to put this out there, so thank you.
There you go. Good luck. I hope we don't destroy your channel.
Nice.